Jonathan, wait for it. Houston, Texas.
H-Town?
H-Town. What's up? H-Town in the house, my friend.
North from Dallas.
You know what? It's not a bad thing, because when I did radio, I used to work at Kiss FM.
Woo! Kiss FM.
Yes, sir. I was on after Kid Craddock, if you remember Kid.
Kid Craddock.
Yes, yeah. And I'm Morales. What's that?
Kid Craddock in the morning. Isn't that what you say?
That's it. And I was on after Kid, and I was Dave Morales. Yeah, I'm the Morales from Kiss FM, but I'm from Houston. So I moved back after Kiss and then got into television, and I get to speak with wonderful people like you. And actually, we're gonna start. What's that?
I love you. I used to listen to you all the time then, Kiss FM. Because there's only two stations, K104, right? Mm-hmm. And Kiss FM. You just oscillate between two.
Yeah. That's it. Well, thank you for listening to me. This is cool. Well, you know what? Let me tell you something. When I was doing research, getting ready to talk with you, by the way, fantastic performance. This movie, powerful. And we're going to break it down here in a second. But, you know, I read that you have family in Texas. That's why I brought that up. You actually mentioned that you have rodeo in your blood, and that actually maybe helped you with the horseback riding and the roping. Is that true? First of all, did that help with this particular film?
Look, man, you need all the help you can when you got to do that stuff, you know? So the simple fact that, you know, yeah, there's some rodeo folk in my family in Waco, Texas. Like, we can talk like that, right? Down in Waco, where our farm is and stuff. So, yeah, I mean, that was helpful. You know, it gives you confidence. Mind you, I've not been to a rodeo that my family was working at, you know what I mean? But I do know that's where they went, you know what I mean? But my grandfather, you know, I was around horses from a very young age. And, you know, you just pick it. It's just common for us, you know, a little bit. But to ride like Nat Love rides, that's a different thing. You know, that's a different thing.
Waco, Texas, the home of Dr. Pepper, my friend. You know what I'm talking about.
Dr. Pepper. How many flavors? Let's not count them.
23. It's either 23 or 32. I should know this.
I'm going to say it's 23 or 32.
Yeah, it's one of those numbers. I can't remember if they're flipped which way. I want to talk about 32, your particular. 32. Yeah, it might be. It might be that. I just know it's good. And I know.
Michael Jordan, you remember that. You remember that.
Yes. Well, you remember. Of course. I mean, Michael Jordan, the best. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, you don't forget that. I was also doing research on Nat Love, your particular character. And while at the beginning of the film, it says, while the stories may be fictionalized, the characters are very real. So then I went down a rabbit hole learning more about Nat. But I'm going to let you talk about, you know, as you research this character, you know, knew Billy the Kid, ran into him. This guy was something else. And what did that feel to portray a person like him that existed?
What can I say to that? I'd say he also wrote an autobiography. I don't know if you got a chance to, I doubt it, but everything you're talking about is in the autobiography. And I really just used and thought of Harder They Fall as a missing chapter in it, you know, because as you said, the Billy the Kid reference, the fact that he was so good with his gun, the fact that he could read a brand from any place at any time, that he had traversed certain areas, ultimately became a porter. All of that was like, okay, cool. From Tennessee, you know, was a slave, all these things about him. We used all of it. You know, that only came to me, you know, once the role settled and I said, okay, we got to get busy, you know. But yeah, he's an incredible, incredible character, but he also existed, you know? So there's a world for me where I go, no, the events of Harder They Fall, they happened. They happened, you know?
All right, we're going to close with this. I want to know the impact that this role had on you.
Wow. There are roles that, you know, test your spirit. You know, there are roles that, you know, you really got to back up, you know, all the shit you talk, you know what I mean? You know, say, okay, do it now. Yeah, it's up. Nat Love really tested my mettle in a way of patience, you know, with the craft and, you know, patience with myself. I mean, I sat, you know, I just stayed in New Mexico. You know, I'm not from New Mexico. I stayed in New Mexico when we were locked down, you know, for the, and kept working on the script. And sometimes it was hard, but it was the idea that, you know, the commitment to the craft, the commitment to, you know, doing this role and the sacrifice of what it would yield, you know, and that's what I learned. You know, would I want to do that again? No, but I did learn, you know, what you're made out of to a degree, you know, how much you really care about it, you know, because we could have walked away, you know, could have walked away from it. But chose not to.
I like you, my man. Thanks for listening to me. Thanks for talking to Dr. Pepper. I want to interview you in person one day. Seriously, thanks for your time. You are amazing, my friend. You're amazing.
Yeah, likewise.
Thanks, bud. Well, if it isn't Stagecoach Mary, how are you?
I'm so good. How are you?
Well, I got to tell you right now that I think you have the best character name of anybody in this movie. I love Stagecoach Mary. And let me tell you I just told your director, I love Westerns. So I was just captivated with this film. Your performances, the entire cast, you were amazing. I want to know how you got ready, because the way you handled the shotgun and the shootout scenes and the fight scenes, looks like you've been doing this your whole life.
Oh, I'm so glad we fooled you. We, you know, had just like a lot of, prep beforehand. I want to say months, how long before we were there, before we started shooting. Anyway, at least like we had, before we started shooting every day, we had something we called a cowboy camp, where we would be horseback riding and doing, you know, learning our specific guns. You know, we all kind of had a different little thing going on, or like specialty weapon. I think that, you know, the point, you know, obviously you can learn to pull a trigger or load something quickly, but you know, we really wanted it to feel like this was something we've done thousands of times, and, you know, that we know our horses, and we really know, we have a relationship with them. They trust us, we trust them. And, that really only comes through repetition. And, so throughout shooting, while we were shooting, you know, if you had days off, or even if you just had free time and you were on set, we would be practicing horse riding, our guns, and then, of course, you know, hand-to-hand combat where that applied. But yeah, I'm so glad it came across that we all knew what we were doing, because we kind of did.
Well, I don't even own a gun. I'm not going to get political, but yeah. I know nothing about it.
Okay.
The weapons, but I love westerns.
Much either, so.
No, but I love westerns, and and so does your director. And I was talking to James about it, and I love watching westerns. And this story is so compelling that I recognize when it looks authentic and real. And you all certainly did that. That being said, these people existed. James was telling me about it. Your director and writer and producer, Stagecoach Mary. Tell me your thoughts about her as you became this character, and what stood out most to you?
Yeah, you know, I read a bunch about her. I read a bunch about all the characters in the film, and I really wanted to make sure that I got her spirit in this film. You know, so much of the film isn't based on her, just based on the structure of the story and sort of this fantasy that James put together of like all these like iconic people of the West kind of coming together like in Avengers superhero movie and sort of like having a romp. You know, it doesn't leave room for much historical accuracy in terms of who these people were really. You know, like Nat and Mary in the film are lovers, and Nat and Mary in real life were not. So, you know, Jonathan and I were building backstory, and, you know, Mary, you know, when she kind of made history, you know, she was a much older woman, and, you know, I just turned 30. And so, you know, there was like a lot of non-parallels, but I still wanted to make sure that, you know, in reading about her, that I was able to take elements of her spirit, some of which I think is sort of, she was really tough, and I think also because women specifically in the West had a really hard time. There weren't a lot of them, and you needed to be able to protect yourself, and you needed to be able to hold your own and survive. And, you know, I think there was very much this like survivor spirit in Mary Fields. And I really wanted my Mary to have that element as well. You know, she owned a restaurant, the real one. My Mary owns a saloon. And, you know, I think being a businesswoman and being able to provide for herself was something I wanted to come across in this film. So yeah, like that, those elements, I was able to kind of move into the character. And then there were a lot of elements that we made up and played pretend with.
I'll tell you what, if I'm going into a fight, I'm not taking a bunch of guys. I'm only taking Stagecoach Mary. That's all I need is a Stagecoach Mary. We're going to end with this. I want to talk about the sets. I want to talk about what it felt like while you were filming. And James did tell me, again, your director, told me about how they the town was there, but they built some of the things. But it just looked so authentic, Old West. Tell me what it was like when you walked onto that set for the very first time in Santa Fe, New Mexico. You looked around, and what were the first things that you were thinking?
It was incredible, because it was truly built out. You know, there weren't really any facades. You could go into the buildings, and it was, like such a gift to be able, as an actor, to be able to really interact with your environment. And it was, what was also cool is there were multiple towns. So, you know, Redwood was different, which is like the Idris, Regina, Keith town, essentially, was different from Douglas, which was my town. And I, you know, felt so much ownership when we went to my town where like my saloon was. And I was like, this is my spot. And, you know, comparing the two and really being able to physically interact, always so helpful. And then particularly in like something so stylized and period where, it's hard. And, you know, like, you know, when I did Deadpool or something like that, you know, a lot of it was built out, and then there was a lot of green screen as well. And, you know, when something is super heightened, you know, your imagination just has to go in overdrive essentially, but it just makes it a lot easier when you go that imagine shit and you can just see it. And so that was really fun to be able to, I don't know, I felt much more authentic.
Well, I love your spirit, and I think you're amazing, and you did a great job. Be proud. This movie's fantastic. Thanks again for your time today. I really, really enjoyed this conversation. This was awesome.
Me too.
This isn't your first film, Western. They Die by Dawn, which premiered at South by Southwest in 2013. You know, you write, you directed this, you're a producer. What inspired you to tell this story?
Well, you know, it's interesting. I love Western so much. This is my debut feature film. You know, They Die by Dawn was a short film, and it was awesome for me, and a great learning experience as well. I love Western so much, but I was always frustrated at the narrow scope, the narrow vantage point they will tell us the stories through. There was no space either side for accurate portrayals of women. Women were always kind of subservient in those tales. People of color were always subservient or treated less than human, or in the case of black people, always given reason for why they're in that story at that time. They used to be a slave owned by this person. He's gonna, you know, like really, for me, I really wanted to bring a more balanced perspective and show you that black people were around those times living amongst themselves and doing their own thing. And so were every person of color. They weren't what Hollywood was depicting was simply not true. And then you have like women. I wanted to tell a story where the women, man, are just as powerful as the men, and they're super gangster and G'd up, and so all of that for me makes up what The Harder They Fall is and the story I wanted to tell with it.
I love that, James. And that is what drew me into this particular film. And then when I went down my own rabbit hole of research, Nat Love, who ran into Billy the Kid, Stagecoach Mary, these people existed. These people were real. And I want to know, as you researched and uncovered the layers, What surprised and stuck out to you most about these outstanding individuals?
Well, I would say, because as opposed to research per se, I was just learning about them growing up because I loved Western so much and I wanted more. So it was almost like I cheated because it wasn't research for me. It was education, but I wasn't doing it for any other reason outside of I just loved the genre. I loved that period in history. So I would read those books like comics. The thicker the book, the more it was a comic. By the time I had grown, now I'm a man. Like by the time I'd grown into a man, like this stuff was kind of second nature to me, who these people were and what wasn't second nature to me, what I could not understand is why we'd never seen them on the big screen before. Why we've never seen them on screen and en masse. That's what stuck out to me the most. How we've never seen these amazing characters with these amazing stories ever depicted on screen. How we've never seen a Cherokee Bill before. You know, what stuck out to me is how gangster they were in real life.
When Cherokee Bill
was being executed, they said, any last words? He said, I came here to die, not make a speech.
It gets you. James, I have to get this in, my friend. I want to know where you filmed. How did you get the Western town? Were those built up? It looks awesome on screen. I want to know where you filmed and how you made this come to life.
Everything was on location. We filmed in New Mexico, Santa Fe. I had a production designer called Martin West, who is a genius, and he totally understood every single area I needed to go cinematically, just with the camera. The town was already there, but we built the huge Mayor's Mansion on the back, and I had to build a cable cam rig right from the back of that mansion, right down the road to where Jonathan Majors is on his horse, and the whole thing was just fire. It was just an awesome thing. And to have all the actors on location as well, when you're directing and knowing that everywhere we turn is a 360 degree world of the story we're in. So it was a blessing. It was beautiful. And I can't be more thankful for that experience.
James, you're just wonderful. Great to meet you. One day I hope to watch a Western with you in person. That would be awesome.
We should do the Wild Bunch.
Dude, that would be so great.